All right, well, we'd like to thank everyone for coming out tonight to UICA. Before we get started, I just want to let you know about a couple of really exciting upcoming events here. As part of our Urbanity exhibition, we have something we're calling the Urbanity Challenge. That is Saturday, June 2nd, starting at 7 p.m. And we have invited some local artists who have been challenged to create installations responding to the theme of the Urbanity exhibition and to work together to install their pieces in UICA's four-story vertical project space. And this work responds to ideas of transportation, advertising, construction, and homelessness. The artists participating in this challenge are Erwin Erkfitz, Alin Guerra, you and I and me, and Dinderbeck. It should be really exciting to see what they all come up with. We also would like to tell you about the Graham and UICA's Neighbor Nights, which is Friday, June 8th, starting at 7 p.m. here at UICA. And the objective here of this wonderful opportunity to collaborate is to offer guests the opportunity to view two museums for the price of one, and you will hear from UICA and Graham curators about the Urbanity and Cities in Transition exhibitions and discuss how the artwork addresses urban experience. Again, the tour here of the Urbanity exhibition begins at 7 p.m. here at UICA, and then the party continues down the street at the Graham. And just a quick note about summer art camp for children ages 5 to 13. That begins June 11th. Please visit our website, uica.org, for more information about all of these wonderful events and programs. So without further ado as to why you all are here, we're very pleased once again to present another Penny Stamps Speaker Series artist, Nick Tobier. And UICA is also very delighted to continue this relationship with the University of Michigan's School of Art and Design so that we may present West Michigan audiences with the University of Michigan's inspiring and thought-provoking programs. This evening's lecture is in part sponsored by Theodore Lum in memory of Clara Olds Bissell. Okay, so a little bit about Nick. I've had the pleasure to meet Nick today. He's a wonderful fellow, and his art is in the Ray Street Gallery if you haven't had a chance to see some very funny video works, little narratives. So Nick is currently an associate professor at the University of Michigan's School of Art and Design, where he has taught since 2003. He is a native New Yorker, and Nick is a lifelong participant observer of street life and the social life of public spaces. These inherently layered scenarios are at the core of his work as artist and educator, and Tobier's practice and pedagogy reflect his belief in the power of social dynamicism and the fundamental role of artist as catalyst and conduit in this relationship. In his current research and teaching, Nick focuses on the integration of art in society and actively challenges artists to expand their self-definitions and scope. These efforts have included partnerships with artists and farmers, critical and celebratory involvements between artists, art students, and broad communities, lectures as performance and vice versa, and a growing commitment to lasting partnerships, working with creative individuals and communities from Detroit and Copenhagen. So ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Nick Tobier.
Thank you. Thanks for that introduction. Thanks for having me. Ryan, is this about the right distance? I can't see anything up there, but someone's... Okay. So there's... And there's nothing up there. Does it come up now? Is this the first... This is not part of the... I'm going to press a button. It's all going to explode. Hold on a second. Let's see. That's it? Okay. Yay! Okay, I'm done. I'm going to sit back down now. Well, in the context of your Urbanity exhibition, I thought I would share with you what my roots are in a certain sense. This is where I grew up in New York. This is the house that I lived in. It's the same block that my father grew up on. And at the time when I was growing up in New York in this neighborhood, most of the blocks around us kind of looked like this. There was like a standing building or so, and then there was a gap. And it sort of looked like a gap-toothed smile And at some point, there were sort of more gaps than teeth. The whole neighborhood has sort of been leveled and rebuilt with these huge towers, this Whole Foods and Michaels and Blockbuster, and you barely recognize it. But my parents were really committed to living in the city that they had grown up and to raising me and my sister there. That's me. I'm the one with the big hair. In a rare moment of sibling pleasantries between us. But it's also, as I said, it's where I grew up and it's where my hair grew up. And it's something that my mother seemed to take like great pleasure in not cutting. I didn't know that I could do it myself, but it caused me to become sort of a street presence, and people would yell things at me on the street. Like it was Ronald in the house, or Hey Lucille Ball, things like that. Or just Yo Big Head was a big one. And although it gave me this great visible presence, it wasn't something that I particularly wanted. And I guess in most ways I felt sort of vulnerable in the city. One time there was this ice cream truck. There was always an ice cream truck that would show up in the summer, and it had sort of bulletproof glass with a little slot cut in it, and you would slide your money in through the glass to get, and then the ice cream would come out this little door. And one time the ice cream man leaned through the door and he said, "Hang in there, big head." And I thought there was like some ringing endorsement or get out quickly. But I took the subway starting at a pretty young age to and from school. This is the station. And this is what the trains looked like at that time. And they were covered in this fantastic graffiti. And you really had to wait till the doors opened so you could tell what was a door. You know, then it would just reveal a light area with more graffiti. And years later, when I was taking art history, there was an article about my neighborhood. And it described graffiti as the markings made by alienated urban youth who felt that their environment was hostile to them. And since they didn't have after-school art programs, this is what they did. And it's probably accurate in some ways that I felt alienated by the city that I grew up in. The inside of the train sort of, as I said, looked like this. I was really proud of this. This is a picture I took with my 110 Instamatic camera. And the guy who's eating opposite you with that great late 70s mustache is underneath a sign that says no eating. But it's so covered in graffiti that you can't see it. And there's also a sign next to it that says no photography. So it's sort of a lawless place in some ways, but I was really proud of the photo. So even though I lived in a big sort of messy city and people yelled at me on the street, I felt fairly lonely. And I wanted to get out of there as quickly as possible. Like in some ways, I think of my early relationship to an urban place as something so confusing to what I do now. I wouldn't have predicted it, but I left as soon as I could go to college and get away, where I made sort of wooden sculptures that I described as metaphors for my youthful experience. These were, I think I described this one as the sort of monolithic apartment block that with fortified windows where people were isolated from their environment. So although it was quite true, it didn't help me feel any better. And I made things like this. This was the smallest apartment I could imagine. It's 1 feet by 4 feet by 6 feet, and there's a place to read, and there's a little place for storage on top, and you can sleep above it. You know, I did come back to the city after college, and I couldn't, you know, still sort of making things like this. And I had a job at the Fulton Fish Market, which was down in Lower Manhattan. My grandfather had an ice business, and I worked at night and came home in the day smelling like fish. So you have a slight understanding of what my social life was like at that point. And one night when I was walking home, I saw an elephant walking down the street. I don't know if you've seen an elephant walking down the street. I hadn't up until that point. And I was astounded. I'd stopped dead in my tracks. And I looked around, and there were other people on the street at 2 in the morning, 4 in the morning, I think, watching this elephant walk down the street. And behind the elephant was a man with a bucket and a shovel. And he got a bigger round of applause than the elephant. But the thing that was sort of stunning to me was that this was so remarkable. And I, not only the elephant, but the man behind him with the bucket. And I didn't know that what happens every year is that Ringling Brothers parks its trailers on the Queens side or Long Island City. And the trailers are too big to get through the Queens Midtown Tunnel. So they take the animals out and they walk through the tunnel to get to Madison Square Garden. And it's a yearly event and planned, but it was a surprise to me. So that night I decided to give up my studio, and I wanted to sort of dedicate myself to being someone else's elephant. So I got rid of the place that I worked, which was a great savings of $75, I think, at that point, near the fish market, and I started building things on the street that would at least in my estimation, make a bigger connection to me and the city that I felt alienated from. Instead of making metaphors about it, I wanted to sort of address it more directly. So I built, this is one of the early ones I just put in here, is a bridge to cross puddles. So when the snow melts, and you might have experienced this in a city where there's no, you know, the catch basins clog up and forms these little lakes, and I stand on a little pontoon that's in my hand over there, and I had this thing that I thought was a uniform, which is the blue shirt. I don't know why that was a uniform. And I'd help people walk across the street. And most frequently, the people who stopped were older people or slightly people who had time on their hands. And they'd say these wonderful things to me, like, I'm so glad the city finally decided to do something about these puddles, which was great to me to presume that, you know, up until then, it was all a heavy constructed metaphor that no one really seemed to care about. But as soon as it became part of daily life, it meant not only more to me, but to the people who were encountering it. Oh, I like this picture. This is the bridge dreaming of becoming a great bridge someday at the base of the Brooklyn Bridge. So it was the bridge. For me, while I was operating the bridge, I was not unlike the man with the bucket. That is, I was walking behind the elephant, ready to shovel what it made, and I had a reason for being that was communicating directly with people around me. But I was interested in the idea of work, that if I did these things in the middle of the street, in the middle of the day, no one would ask me, they would ask what it was, but I didn't have to explain it in some complex sort of theoretical creative rhetoric that even I didn't understand. And I got really inspired by people who did work that might have been invisible to everybody else, but was enjoyed by others. So some of the first people I was really alert to were chefs who made this remarkable stuff, but you didn't actually get to meet them, or they didn't sign it. You know, in some ways, we ingest so many wonderful experiences, and we, as sort of visual artists and designers, have at times some sort of ego problem that doesn't recognize that other people make wonderful things. So this is Chef Leon of what was then the Edison Hotel on the trampoline there. And at that point in the 20s and 30s, they were really famous for their soufflés. And one of the things that he would do with his kitchen staff is they'd all go up onto the roof before the lunch prep, and they'd do these exuberant calisthenics with their whisks so that they would feel light. And I just thought that was beautiful, that it was a use of a uniform, of a tool, to feel that you not only belong to something, but you had a craft. And so there was a whole body of work that I've made that's sort of inspired by that. I'll just put a couple in to show you. I was invited by an organization called City Space in San Francisco to partner with Muni, which was the bus, the rapid transit system, or not rapid transit system. And they invited artists to do projects with the bus, but all the projects seem to be the signs on the bus with something ironic or satirical. But I asked if I could work on the bus, and they asked what I'd like to do. So I rode this bus for a week, the 22 Fillmore. And I recognized that the driver had a lot going on, and there was a lot of chaos in the back of the bus. And it went through a lot of neighborhoods that were off the tourist beaten track, through immigrant neighborhoods, through sort of underseen, lower-income African-American neighborhoods that are not part of the Rice-A-Roni commercials. So I dressed up as this bus attendant, this sort of self-appointed bus attendant. I would ride the bus all from the very beginning to the very end in the morning, and then I'd walk back and I'd clean all the stops with my whisk broom and my white gloves, and I'd greet people, and then I'd get on the bus, and then I'd buff the seats with that thing in my hand that I call my puffy. And I'd get to know everybody at the stop. I did this for a month, and I got to know the drivers and the bus line. I even, as someone visiting the city, I felt reasonably comfortable giving directions. And some of the things that I loved that happened from it is that Muni decided to hire 8 public transit ambassadors who rode the buses. In some ways, some nefarious thoughts are that so teenagers wouldn't do graffiti on the back. But I like to think in some ways that my presence inspired some action. And I think that most of this work, if it's successful, not only gives someone pause to think, oh, that's neat, why didn't, you know, that's, I guess that's happening now. Or I could do that on my own, or I could do something like that. So a lot of it is about taking action and noticing things that you'd like to impact. Now, about 5 years ago, the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor decided to open this building in Detroit to act as a bridge between the university and the state's largest city, having once been founded there. They had opened an admissions office and a gallery which has a front door on Woodward Avenue that's always locked. So you either have to buzz or you have to go in through the secure parking. And I was curious about the distance between, not only geographic between Ann Arbor and Detroit, but what the gallery was saying, which was to anyone walking by, you're not welcome. By design, your permission is somewhat denied. And most of the people who were right outside would have been a fantastic audience. And mostly they were waiting for the bus. And the wait is up to anywhere from 80 minutes to 2 hours at this point. And they wait in the sun and in the rain and in the snow at what looks like a stick in the road with a metal sign. So I decided that if the university was going to do something, they should at least spend a little time getting to know the people in the neighborhood. And I volunteered, unbeknownst to anybody but myself, to be that sort of ambassador. So I made a bus bench for people to wait in. It had a canopy at certain points and an upholstered seat that I took apart from something else. And I would sit at it. This is because I have a teaching job, so I have time in the summer to do things like this. And I'd talk to people about their day, about anything. And the bus stop sort of amended itself along the way. Added a radio, water. Someone suggested I sell loose cigarettes, but I thought that wasn't something I should get into for taxation reasons. But it was for me a really important introduction to getting to know a place that I didn't know well, that continues the line of thinking that the bus attendant in San Francisco did. I do have to add this autobiographical note. My mother would be proud of me to mention it. But at a certain point in my work, I thought I was interested in public space and cities. I should professionalize myself. That was my father talking there. So I went to study landscape architecture, which I then practiced professionally. And I was interested then, as I am now, in public spaces, much more social than botanical. But I went to a school, this school that looked really scary. It's a big place where everybody was working all the time and was fiercely competitive. So even though everybody was studying urban planning, landscape architecture, and architecture, sort of allegedly social fields, they really didn't want to talk to each other. What they wanted to do was win. And it was, you know, I learned a lot, and the credentials are useful, and I practice a lot of the things that I learned. But I spent my last year, which should have been my thesis year, but I turned this project into my thesis. I built this little tea cart that I could wheel up and down the aisles, and I would ask people to take a break from their project and have a conversation with one another. And there was a little hot plate that made mint tea and a radio and water, and yet in order to have it, you had to sit at these little chairs. And in order to plug it in, you had to unplug one of your things, your computer or your electric eraser. So it was really hard work to get people to participate. And I thought I'd put this in because I know Robert Hammond spoke here about the High Line. I still practice with the firm that I used to work with, but we do like a special project each year. So we'd done a competition entry for the High Line, which is, if you hadn't seen the talk or haven't seen it, was a former elevated rail line, now abandoned, turned into a beautiful park on the far west side of Manhattan. And there was a competition for its rebuilding, and we didn't win. But I really do like my proposal. And I know that frequently when they talk about the High Line, that they mention the roller coaster is one of the most far-fetched proposals. So the idea was to create a roller coaster that would provide a far west side transit link, as well as some link back to features like Coney Island, so that there was a way to combine the necessity of transit with the joy of travel. And it would link into bike paths and walking paths and existing transit systems. And there was an elephant shuttle to get from the far west side further. But as I said, it wasn't chosen, but I'm proud of that it created some conversation. Besides, for all but a few years, I've lived in some sense in larger places. Ann Arbor, I would not call large, but I spend a lot of time in all my work in Detroit. But I lived for a few years, 4 years, in a beautiful remote village, Alfred, New York, in rural western New York State. And I had gotten some traveling fellowship from graduate school to go to Rome. And right after I came back from Rome, I went to Alfred. This is in September. And a week later, this is what I saw. It was a ferocious ice storm on September 16th, knocking out all foliage and all color. This was not infrequent in this part of the country. It's a place that global warming seems to have forgotten. And there was an amazing monochrome wipeout. It was the first time I had really spent time in a small town and it was all of a sudden brown or gray, and everybody wears Carhartt everything, so they are equally sort of colorless. So I built this. This is a hot chocolate cart on wheels that I could set up. As you can see, it's a friendly town, so the police officer's not giving me a ticket, but asking for one to go. And you could step into it, and it's all red and warm inside, and have hot chocolate and get out of the snow, and it was terrific. And it made me forever recognize that some of the urban concerns I had had about sociability were not so much to do with cities, but to do with interacting with other people. And I continue to think of that. It's not the size of the place or the apparent complexity on the surface, but recognizing that people are complex individuals, and interaction is one of the things that makes us social animals. Just as I was leaving Alfred, I built this thing that I love. It's a tricycle powered chandelier. So I transfer all the energy that the hub generators would normally do to a headlight or taillight, and it lights up the chandelier above my head. So when I pedal, it lights, and there are little crystals on it. And you can see there are people peering out their window, like, what is that guy doing? And one day, I'd ride it around at night, and people would throw slices of pizza at me or yell freak. But I liked that. It reminded me of being Big Head. And when I ride it around Detroit at night in neighborhoods that don't have streetlights, it has a completely different implication. It provides public lighting in places that are really dark. And people applaud or just watch it go by or ask to ride it. So when there are more people on the street, the interaction with things like this is really different. Since I have this background in landscape architecture, I'm often called in to do things that I think someone assumes are going to involve plants. And sometimes they do, and sometimes they don't. But early on in my time in Ann Arbor, I was invited by the university and the city to come up with a proposal to treat the gateway to Ann Arbor, this stretch of South State Street. If you come in on 94 and get off of the State Street exit and drive up State Street, that's the gateway to Ann Arbor. There's no sign, by the way, that says you have arrived, and that seemed tragic to me. So we came up with all sorts of solutions. I worked with a group of architects and city planners, and we came up with easily the most, dullest thing I've ever come up with in my life, which was maize and blue plantings that are there, but they look like weeds, but it was palatable to everybody. I had suggested early in the process that we just move the marching band practice site from off-site to that intersection, so when people came by, they'd see the marching band, and they'd think it was for them. And everybody said, ha, 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 ha. And I said, no, I'm serious. So I did it. I decided to do it on my own. I formed a marching band with a group of musicians that I put together, brass musicians who hadn't known each other before, and I made these uniforms. The uniform making, it goes back to the chefs and their things. I love the process of building these things. So I make my uniform for the bus attendant and for the marching band. And we're studiously avoiding maize and blue or any school spirit or anything, just so everybody knows it's not part of a sports club. And we would march up and down this strip, and we would play for... Oh, I forgot to... When we first started, the musician, I had forgotten to ask them if they could march and play their instruments at the same time. So the answer was no. So we stood for the first 3 weeks. We were a standing band, and you can see this picture of us with our music stands. So it's sort of sweet and goofy, but cars would honk. And I have a short video clip for this, so if we could hit that first one there. I hope I got that one right. Oops. Something's happening. Thank you. I like that one. So you see, when we march by, the sign says no. No parking, no RVs, permit required. I thought that was a remarkably bad message to welcome people into town. The signs are still up, but the band is no longer. The thing about doing the band on my own after the city and the university planner said it's not a great idea is I recognize that my ambitions as a landscape architect designer didn't sort of match my temperament. That is, I really wasn't good at waiting to do something, to go through a long process of planning, at least at that point. And I thought of how powerful it felt to be sort of a solitary agent who could make something like this happen. And so I think the sort of next group of work just describes some of these actions, which is I'm really going to take it into my own hands. The transition from being a studio sculptor to someone who did things on the street, incorporating sort of more and more people, or at least more complexity in places. But I worked in this other small place, which is the town my mom grew up in eastern Long Island in New York. When I was a kid, we'd go out there every summer and stay with my grandparents. I think my parents would drop us off and leave, now that I think of it. That's amazing. And there was this great July 4th parade. It wasn't July 4th. There was a minor Revolutionary War battle, so minor that you won't find it in most history books. But every year, the same group of guys, other kids' dads, because my dad wasn't there, would reenact this battle. And they'd have these sort of wooden and cardboard muskets, and they'd say, "The British are coming, the British are coming." And they'd always go through the same sequence, and everybody would clap, and then there was a clam bake. But recently, the town has become a lot fancier, and there are all these new arrivals who've gotten on town council. And they decided about 5 years ago to get rid of the reenactment because they thought it was tacky. And I thought it was a huge loss for collective memory as well as an event, so I decided to reenact the reenactment on my own. And I built this tricycle. I'm big on bikes and building them. This tricycle was made from a bunch of bikes that I put together, and it has this cannon on the front that's capable of firing a small projectile, like 10 feet. And I dressed myself as every invader the town had ever known. So I was a whaler, and I had my tassel loafers and my cordless phone headset, because everybody driving their Hummers can't be bothered to stop. And on the day that the reenactment used to exist, I rode into town, and I was play the next video and you can see how everybody's stirred up in revolutionary fervor. I had taken the trouble to get a parade permit from the village hall, but I was stopped by the police, not because I didn't have a parade permit, which they didn't seem to know what it was, but because I was slowing traffic down and someone had called from their car to complain. So sad. So I said, that's my point. So I do think, you know, there's a certain amount of this that I do on my own, and then there's a certain amount I do with other people. And I feel incredibly fortunate to get to teach, both at the University of Michigan and in Detroit. I teach a fourth grade class in Detroit and a ninth grade class, and often the two groups of students are together. I think working, you know, in some ways having the opportunity to teach gives me two things always. One is it gives me a ready supply of people who are willing to try something out, you know, who are somewhat optimistic. And it also gives a context for someone to say, that is just such a terrible idea. But the first time I came to Grand Rapids, and I put this in special for here, is I had a completely loopy class where I had taught the students acrobatics. And these were art and design students who were willing to do this. And they wrote and came up with this whole sort of song and dance act. So they'd come tumbling out of this bus, and they'd set up this sign, and they would perform all across the state. So we went to Saginaw, Grand Rapids, Traverse City, Jackson, and we'd perform with school groups. And you can see afterwards some of the things that would happen were just sort of terrific. So sort of the mingling of college students, high school students, and fourth graders I thought was terrific. And by that point, I recognized that the acrobatics were not only important to entertain the crowd, but were to build some net of trust amongst the students in the class so that they felt confident as a group that going out into the world, they had someone had their back and they had something to offer. That's sort of the basis, I think, of a lot of my teaching in Detroit, which works with U of M, largely School of Art and Design students, and a fourth grade, now on the east side of Detroit at a school called Marcus Garvey Academy. And all sorts of, we are basically the entire art curriculum for this public school that doesn't have one. And the relationships that form between the two groups of students are terrific. And it probably about 5 years ago also, around the time I started that bus bench, I recognized that no matter how wonderful the things were that we did in the classroom, the things that were affecting those children's lives were so complex that whatever stresses or skills they had to learn to survive in their neighborhoods on the street didn't necessarily match up with what we wanted to or thought we could want to do in the classroom. So what at first I had understood is a problem for people who couldn't sit still or be quiet in the way that I was used to, I recognized were some of the skills that they had learned. So much of this is compounded by access to nutrition, that the sort of sugary things that a lot of those kids get to eat, not only from the wonderfully horrible school lunches, but is that their access to fresh food in that neighborhood is so limited. So the nearest place to buy food to Marcus Garvey Academy is this corner store that, as you see, features beer and wine and accepts bridge card. And if you go in there, it's hard to find something that resembles produce. So I decided to devote then my summers to working in that neighborhood, to figuring out ways to sort of continue to be involved with both the fourth graders and the community that I had been jetting in and out of to teach art workshops. So I had a great group of U of M students one summer who lived with host families that we paid in the neighborhood, and they, along with the fourth graders, built this sort of fantastic outdoor classroom out of stuff. It's really like Three Little Pigs. Over there, there's Sarah and Farah building this cob bench out of mud and sticks and straw that's still there. And then we timber framed this roof using trees that we cut down or harvested from other parts of the city and built this outdoor classroom for what became a sort of children's gardening program with Earthworks Urban Farm called Growing Healthy Kids. One of the last days we were there, I asked each of the U of M students to come up with something that they could teach someone else so that when we left, we had more than an artifact. So on the right there is Becca teaching these two little girls how to play the ukulele, which is just terrific, all those little voices. And that project that we worked on and started with called Growing Healthy Kids continues to this day. One of the other things I worked on with them for the last few years is these mobile produce businesses that take some of sort of the bike fetish and skills that I have. We built these mobile stands a couple of years ago, and they continue each summer as each kid who has a garden plot wants to do something entrepreneurial with their produce. So here's Tyler, who had a kale stand. I thought, what 11-year-old wants to have a kale stand? But how great that is. They're screening this movie here on the 22nd called Urban Roots. And in it is a project called Food, Field of Our Dreams, that I helped start. You'll see me in it for a little bit, but I asked not to be in it for all sorts of reasons. And you see my butt at one point that they got without my permission there. But I've been eating all of my meals when I'm in this neighborhood at the Capuchin Soup Kitchen, and I've made some great friends. And there they are at this business that we started now 3 years ago called Field of Our Dreams. It's a mobile produce business in some ways designed to complement the work done at Earthworks, but also to remedy some of the things that are affected by the food system. And so we first started with a folding table in the back of my car. Warren on the left described it as the whitest car he had ever seen, the Subaru Forester with an Obama sticker. And next to him is Greg Bostich and Keith Love. And after our first year, we met the then governor, we had a website, and we had regular stops on Tuesdays and Thursdays throughout the east side of Detroit. And we made enough money to buy this small pickup truck on the left, and someone donated the vinyl. And then recently we bought this great ice cream truck that we're in the process of cutting to turn it into a mobile produce market. One of my fourth grade students said, you had better make some announcement that it is not ice cream because people will be really mad if they hear the song and see that. So there's a big connection for me between this work and the work that I would call celebratory. Whoops. The chandeliers and things like the hot chocolate cart. I see the biggest relationship for me is remembering that thing that tipped me off. It was the elephant followed by the man with the bucket and surrounded by all those people who were cheering him on. And I recognize that in so many ways, work, whether we see it or not, in our cities is what makes us keep working. I mean, there are people out there working right now, or they were just 10 minutes ago on Fulton Street, and how much they contribute to the shape of the city, whether you like the noise or not. And I think how often some work is seen and some work is not seen. So there are things that inspire me to keep thinking of how important it is to sort of remove some of the distinctions between what I would describe as beautiful and or useful work, whether it's a distinction between art and design or between functional and quasi-unfunctional, but I think they all have a function. This group up here is called the Red Rockets. They were a sort of radical German workers collective in the 20s who would work in their factory jobs, and then after work, they would stand on the corners exhorting their colleagues to come up with exuberant dances that described the work that they were doing. And I loved, one, that they had the energy to do it, but two, that they had the optimism to recognize that daily movements themselves could be really beautiful. So I look at them on one hand, and then Busby Berkeley, who, if you've never seen things like Neptune's Daughter or Million Dollar Mermaid, you should, where especially in some of the movies where people sweeping or shoveling are understood, that their movements are incredibly beautiful. So I have just two short videos left to show you, but one I wanted to show you because there's another version of it out in the show here, but also because it was in Grand Rapids. So if any of you need to do your laundry, I would highly recommend the Creston Sit and Spin on Plainfield, which was our fantastic host during Art Prize. I was very proud that my projects during Art Prize were almost impossible to find if you were looking for them. But I recognized in the laundromat that there are all these, I mean, I've spent so many hours watching my laundry dry, right? How many of you have done that, right? It's like watching your computer load something. But there's useful time and there's sort of downtime. And as I watched the dryers, I thought of the connection between their rhythms and other rhythms. So if we play the next video, here's a clip from that. That's Hannah and Therese Rosenberg, who are terrific Grand Rapids dancers who have identical dragon tattoos. The last piece I'm going to show you, which is also out there, but I just want to give you a little background on it. I was invited by the City of Toronto to be one of 10 artists who were going to work with these wading pools. And these were pools that were set up by the city in the 30s, I think, to keep immigrants cool in the summer so they didn't agitate or anything messy. And I went up there in the winter, and I met this sort of supervisors of the pools who were these sort of grumpy older guys who were in charge of dealing with high school students who were being punished in some way. So the supervisors were these guys who would yell at the kids to do something. Then I met the high school students, and I asked what their day was like, and they said mainly they chase dogs out of the pool so they don't pee, and they try and avoid their supervisors. So I had the chance to stage this spectacle in these two wading pools, and I took a lot of the information that both sets of workers had given me, and this is the cast that comes up is a combination of those workers, some of those high school students who are being punished in some ways, and some people I brought up with me from Detroit and Ann Arbor. So here's the image standing. There's a real supervisor. No, it's a fake supervisor. Okay. Thank you.